Hi, I'm Nomia. Welcome to My World, where we cover the stories and issues that matter to you. Coming up this week, the young women being targeted for speaking out. We have a special report from Brazil. We hear a lot about the bad points, but are there positive effects of social media? And we talk to the first woman to run for president of Somalia about her struggles to get into politics.
The time has come for women to step forward and to take leadership.
When we asked you what issues you wanted us to cover on My World, gender equality was often at the top of the list. So our top story is about a group of young feminists, people who stand up for equal rights for women, in Brazil. The BBC's gender and identity correspondent, Megha, Mohan, is here with me. And Megha, you went there to investigate.
Yes, I went to Brazil just recently. And the reason I went to Brazil, to Rio, was because Brazil's been on my mind for a little while. That's because a report was released last year that said that Brazil had really high rates of violence against women. There were more than 63,000 cases of sexual attacks against women, and 50% of those were women under the age of 13. So when I started digging into this, I found out about this one woman called Marielle Franco. Now, Marielle Franco was a feminist who was murdered in 2018, and she came from this poor area in Rio called Mare, which is a favela. And I went to that favela to meet young women who had been inspired by Marielle Franco to find out whether this was the most dangerous place to be a feminist.
My name is Lorena, I'm 18 years old, and I am a feminist. You've got to understand that we live with fear. We're afraid to go out, we're afraid to come back, we're afraid to stay at home. I live in a favela in Mare, in Rio, Brazil. And a favela is a community. All my friends are from here. I think it's really good here because everyone lives nearby. I'm never alone. And I think Mare is one of the most dangerous places to be a feminist.
The dangers in Mare come from gang violence and police raids. But women who speak up for feminism can also face extra threats.
I think it's a battle to be a woman here because everything we do here is a political act. When you leave, you don't know what the situation is going to be like when you return. So if you leave Mare, you don't know what you're going to come back to.
But for young women who speak out, there are even more dangers. Marielle Franco was a popular politician who came from Mare. She spoke up for women's rights. She was shot dead in 2018. Her killing struck a nerve. She was black, charismatic, and poor. And thousands of young women saw themselves in her story and protested her death. Marielle's killer kept a list of names. They included human rights activists and Brazilian feminists. The Brazilian press called it a kill list. On the list was Marielle's friend Eliana Souza, who's also from Mare and a community leader.
We're actually under constant threat because of the work we do at Mare. We work on making it more secure, so we denounce the violations committed by the police. And this, in fact, puts me permanently at risk.
Cometidas pela polícia e isso realmente me coloca em risco de uma maneira permanente.
The danger was clear. The day after we met Lorena, there was a 12-hour police raid and a shootout in Mare. The atmosphere had completely changed. This time, Lorena was much more tense.
E não dava também para atravessar a rua.
I couldn't cross the street because I could be hit by a bullet. Everyone was trapped, one in each corner. Nothing was the same. Everything was empty, the stores didn't open, and the people weren't in the streets. Every time there's an operation, there's this mourning vibe. We stay like that. It was a very violent day.
After the shootout, the women of Mare organized a counseling session for the girls. Being a feminist may put Lorena in danger, like it did Marielle Franco before her. But speaking up about equal rights is something she feels she needs to talk about openly, despite the danger.
So I'm surrounded by this the whole time, and there will always be people wanting to silence me, just like there were people who wanted to silence Marielle. But her voice continues to reverberate to this day.
That's Lorena speaking bravely to us from Mare. And Megha, having been there, do you think it is a dangerous place for a feminist?
Mare as a favela complex is a dangerous place, period. You know, there were, just last year, there were 20 police, there were more than 20 gang shootouts, there were more than 30 police raids there. However, there's a particular focus done on what is happening to the women in that area. And there was a study that was done by a number of NGOs and a university, King's College London, that said that, you know, more than 70% of women had experienced violence, and more so when they spoke out as well. And just from being in that favela, being a woman in that, you know, operating in that favela, I did feel that there's this particular attention on you. It could have been because we were outsiders, but definitely in terms of what it is to be a woman in that favela, I do think it's an extremely dangerous place, and I felt vulnerable.
I was going to say, did you feel unsafe at any point?
Well, I didn't on day one. The first day, we had a really great time. People were so welcoming, and, you know, I was just wondering, why do they say that this is such a dangerous place to be? You know, because we had some nice acai, which is a really lovely kind of ice cream from Brazil, and I was really enjoying being there. And then on day two, there was a shootout. There was a 12-hour police raid. They were going into houses, ransacking houses. There was a shootout. Some people died. We couldn't even confirm how many people died. And after that, we saw young boys, you know, on the back of bikes, as young as 9, holding large guns. There were people selling drugs on the street corners. And the women weren't really out in the street as much, I noticed, when we got back. And Lorena herself changed. You know, she kind of went from being a really bubbly personality to being quite quiet. So it definitely is up there, I think, as one of the most dangerous places.
Thank you so much, Megha. Now, anyone can publish a news story on social media or online. That makes it hard to know what and who to trust. Misinformation can reach a huge number of people very quickly. So journalists have to work hard to be transparent about information that's wrong and take steps to correct it quickly.
Now let's turn to Mexico City because rescuers are still trying to reach a number of people that they think are alive,
including a 13-year-old girl
who is sheltering under a table.
They've managed to pass her food and water but still can't free her.
In September 2017, a major earthquake hit Mexico. It toppled buildings and killed more than 200 people. Amongst the devastation, a story of hope emerged.
Well, there has been an extremely tense rescue operation unfolding at this primary school. The rescuers, of course, say they will continue through day and night until every last child is accounted for. And
that child came to be known as Frida Sofia. The story first appeared in Mexico's national news. Rescuers reportedly said they were able to speak to a little girl who was trapped inside a collapsed school. The Mexican Navy appeared to confirm the story that a young girl was alive under the rubble. International media also picked it up, with the New York Times, Associated Press, and the BBC all reporting the story. Some organizations reported Frida's survival as fact. Others, including the BBC, were more cautious, saying that it was unclear whether a girl called Frida Sofia went to the school, but Frida had already gone viral. Messages of support flooded social media. But then the Mexican Navy apologized for its previous statement. They said that the story of Frida Sofia was not a reality, that there were no signs of survivors in the rubble, and there was no evidence that a girl called Frida Sofia had ever gone to the school. So what did this mean for organizations that had already published the story? The BBC wrote a piece explaining the story of Frida Sofia and how misinformation about the story spread around the world. In order to earn the public's trust, journalists must report accurately on events and be open and transparent when information is wrong.
Next up on My World, it's that time when we answer one of the questions you sent in to us. This week it comes from a viewer in Bulgaria's capital city, Sofia.
Hello, my name is Elena. I'm 14 years old and I'm from Rose, Bulgaria. My question is, what are the benefits of social media? This question is important to me because lots of people consider social media unhealthy.
We see it all the time. There's loads of stories around about how bad social media is for us and how large parts of our lives are in the hands of a few massive companies. I'm cybersecurity reporter at the BBC, which means that a big part of my job is holding these big companies to account. I spend a lot of time looking at the negative sides of social media, and I pretty much take the positives for granted. So getting this question is actually really good for me because it can remind me of all the good things that have come about since social media was invented. I grew up in a time before social media, not quite that long ago. We still had mobile phones and the internet, but it wasn't quite like it is now. Everything was much slower and much more difficult. People still mainly communicated by phone call, which means that if you made plans, you had to stick to them. Or you could leave your mate waiting in the rain. And now we're more connected than ever. Most of us are spending time every day with our friends online and sharing our lives with people across the world. If you're feeling isolated or lonely, or if you feel like there's something you need help with, you can find a community through social media who can share their experiences and help you out. All this communication can lead to a greater understanding of each other and also bring some real change. It's hard to imagine something like the climate strike movement spreading as far or as fast as it has without social media. It helped amplify the voice of a 15-year-old activist in Sweden, so she's been heard around the world. And there are some pretty direct benefits too. Tools have been made that encourage people to make the world around them better, whether that's by giving money, telling your friends and family you're safe, or by donating blood. In fact, this alone has led to more than 50 million people becoming blood donors around the world, literally lifesavers. So there really are some great benefits of social media, but it's still really new. These apps are emerging technologies, and when things affect the way that we live and work and do things as much as social media has, it takes a long time to work out what the knock-on effects could be. It's probably up to the next generation to work through some of these problems, and hopefully, if they do a good job, we'll be talking a lot more about the positive side of social media in the future.
Thank you to Helena, really good question. And if you also have any questions that you want us to answer, please do send an email to myworld@bbc.co.uk. Now, still to come on today's show, as more people move from the countryside to cities, we head to China to hear how rapid urbanisation has affected one young person's life. Now, Fadumo Dayib was the first woman to run for president of Somalia, but she faced death threats as a result.
Even though she didn't win, Fadumo told My World why she's determined to stand again.
I decided to make a difference in the lives of Somalis by attempting to run for office in Somalia in 2016. My vision for Somalia was that it's prosperous, peaceful, able to compete with its peers. A Somalia which is not always associated with terrorism, hunger, with famine, and with negative news. I wanted to send a message to Africa. The time has come for women to step forward and to take leadership. In 1989, we were forcefully deported from Kenya. And we ended up in Somalia, in Mogadishu. When the war broke out, my mother, who couldn't afford to come along with us, sent me and my two younger siblings off to find peace. We went through Moscow and ended up in Finland. you ask me who my role model was, it was my mother. She was an amazing, amazing woman. She had lost 11 children, but always very positive, you know, always very focused and inspirational. When I was 14 years, my mother asked me what I wanted to be when I grow up. I wanted to become a secretary in the UN in Kenya. And my mother would say, let's make your dreams become concrete. You have to visualize. Every Saturday, we would go to the UN compound and she would say, look at that entrance, you will enter there one day. And of course I'd try to say, oh no, but I'm not even very good at reading and writing. And she'd say, no, no, see that entrance and keep it in your mind. Every Saturday, my mother and I would drive through my dreams. I think there will be a female president in Somalia, and that female president would probably be me. My advice, hold on. All right. My advice to the 13-year-old Fadumo is to say, keep your head up. You have a long road ahead of you, and you are destined for great things. Keep on dreaming, because it is dreamers who make a change in this world. And don't look behind. Always look ahead.
Now, even though women make up half the world's population, it's men who still make most of the big decisions. Only one in four of all politicians around the world are women. So how do you make politics more equal? Take a look.
Step one, you've got to turn up. For years, women were shut out with no say in who would lead them. Women in Saudi Arabia were only given their right to vote in 2015. But when they do get a fair chance, it can have a big impact. India's big election in 2019 saw the same percentage of women voting as men for the first time, helping to elect more female members of parliament than ever before. Step two, take inspiration from role models. We all want someone to look up to, and it's no different in politics. New Zealand was the first country to give women the right to vote. And their current Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern, is only the second elected world leader to give birth while in office. She was the youngest female Prime Minister in the world when she was elected. But now, that's Finland's 34-year-old Sanna Marin. Miss Ardern is actually the third woman to run New Zealand.
Those previous prime ministers have carved a path for me that I'm incredibly grateful for.
Now she wants to inspire more girls to lead, because even when one woman is elected, it doesn't solve the problem. Step three, targets can help. Setting targets can be controversial, but lots of countries have introduced them to bring more equality. Rwanda in Africa has the most women in parliament. But it wasn't always like this. Back in the 1990s, women only made up a small share of their parliamentary seats. So in 2003, the country set a goal to make 30% of their elected politicians women. And it's worked. Today, they make up nearly two-thirds of the Rwandan parliament. Even though not everyone thinks quotas like Rwanda's are the best solution, it's hard to argue that they don't make a difference.
And to watch that report again, along with any other stories we're covering, do head to the BBC My World YouTube channel.
Finally, a big part of what we do in My World is to report on your stories wherever you live. In China, rapid urbanisation has meant that many people have moved from the countryside to the cities, but often families are separated in the process. Here's Tang's story.
In the past, most people in China lived in the countryside, caring for animals and growing their food. Life was tough. People were poor. Then everything changed. The megacities of China were born. Millions of people flooded the cities searching for new jobs and opportunities. Products made in China traveled throughout the world. But the sons and daughters of these workers had to stay in their rural villages to go to school, separated from their parents. And now millions are known as China's left-behind children.
My name is Tang Yuwen and I'm 11 years old. I live here with my grandmother, my brother and two cousins. My parents don't live here. They work in another city called Chengdu. They both work in clothes factories. Although my parents don't earn much and they don't get to spend time with us, thanks to their hard work, we're not down and out. When mom and dad come back to visit, I run to meet them. I run a very long way because I can't wait to be close to them. What I love most is to go fishing with them. On my own, I can only catch one or two fish, three at most. But when mom and dad are here, we catch lots of fish. During spring festival, mom and dad visit for longer. We set off fireworks to celebrate the new year. It's not easy for mom and dad to come back to visit us. They can only stay for a few days before they have to leave again. I wish they could take me with them. I want to go with them. I don't want to be separated from them. I know it's hard for mom and dad to earn money. I don't want to cause trouble for them, but I miss them so much. It's very painful. But I can't do anything about it because I don't want to bother them. If I call them, I will disturb them. I can't do anything but wait. I really want them to come back. When I grow up, I won't leave here. This is my home. I want to do something big. I'd like to be a boss, run a factory. And I'll take my kids to my workplace so we can stay together.
That was Tang's story. Thank you to him for sharing it with us. And that's about it from me and the team this week. Thank you for watching My World. See you next time.